Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barik ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Qala Sayyidi Imam al-Ghazali rahmatullah ta'ala, Ayyuhal Walad, kam min layalin ahyaytaha bitakrari al-amali wa mutala'ati al-kutub wa harramta ala nafsika al-nawm. La a'lamu ma kana al-ba'ithu fih in kana nayla arad al-dunya وجذب حطامها وتحصيل مناصبها والمباهات على الأقران والأمثال فويل لك ثم ويل لك وإن كان قصدك فيه إحياء شريعة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وتهذيب أخلاقك وكسر النفس الأمارة بالسوء فطوبى لك ثم طوبى لك ولقد صدق من قال شعرا سهر العيون لغير وجهك ضائع وبكائهن لغير فقدك باطل.
O child, how many a night did you spend awake in pursuance of knowledge and studying of books, depriving yourself of sleep? I am unaware of your motivation for it. If it was to attain worldly fame, or to acquire the vanities of the world and achieve rank and position in it, or to boast in vainglorious competition with peers and the like, then woe to you and again woe to you. However, if your intention was to keep alive the Sharia of the Prophet ﷺ and to refine your character and to break the desires of the lower self that entices to evil, then hail to you and again hail to you. And it is surely true what the poet of this verse said, the vigil of the eyes is wasted for other than your sake, and tears for other than the loss of you are all but fake.
Here, Sayyidina al-Ghazali, he highlighted the importance of the intention. Okay, the same deed, you may have it for certain diseases, you know, or sicknesses, you know, in this life. He highlighted of them, you know, which may be felt otherwise that it's a healthy thing to be done. He highlighted when you seek some dunya purpose, you know, or some benefit in this life, or to get to be highly respected by someone, or to show yourself as superior than the others. You see, each word of this which has been mentioned by Imam Ghazali, we should pay a lot of attention to it. Again, what is it, you know, when you seek any benefit of this life, when you try to show your rank in this life, or when you try to show superiority over the others, and these are warning signs, you know, and that's why Imam Ghazali gave you the warning word for it, you know. Whereas, when you have in the same way of practice, your intention to resurrect or to make it alive, you know, the prophetic, you know, instruction of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What other noble aim of this, you know, to have good characters, you know, inside yourself, or to put down your passion, you know, or your nafs, okay? And this here, he give you the good news, you know, and good tiding, you know, tuba laka. And both of these wording, you know, they have been used in the Qur'an. The first one, tuba, to give you the good tiding, you know, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or from someone else, you know. And the other one, waylun, has been mentioned also in the Qur'an to give you the bad, you know, news about certain things, you know, in your life. Any question about them? And here, as you may see, he emphasized a lot, you know, on the deeds, on your practice. Besides this, he wants you to have the intention, and this has been, even though it has been mentioned in the Holy Hadith, you know, no doubt, no argument, you know, about it, you know. Again, when you try to recon yourself, when you try to adjust yourself, you are going to find a lot of problems, you know, there. Any question? No questions? Okay, move to the other paragraph we know of it. أيها الولد عش ما شئت فإنك ميت وأحبب ما شئت فإنك مفارق وأعمل ما شئت فإنك مجزي به.
O child, live as you please, you are bound to die one day. Love whatever you wish, you are bound to part from it one day. Act as you please, you will be recompensed accordingly.
I put them alone, you know, even though this is a short text, just to highlight that this is derived from a holy hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I was asked before, how come Imam Ghazali, you know, doesn't mention his chain, you know, or relate this hadith? I told the person, you know, even in the time of the companion, when they have the complete trust, you know, among themselves, they did not use the way of narration used among the muhaddithin, you know. When they start to show, not themselves, you know, when it started to show some lies, you know, or whatever, then they start to show their chains, you know. So apparently here, Imam al-Ghazali, since he took from some previous book, many of these ahadiths, they are taken from previous book. The most famous book, you know, the Imam al-Ghazali has relied on it, you know, was Qutul Qulub, written by Abi Talib al-Makki. Most of these ahadiths, you are going to find it in that particular book. And the same problem that we have, that there's no chains, you know, of this matter. Here he did not say it is hadith, even though it is a sound hadith that Sayyidina Jibreel came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the same pattern here, live to whatever long you want to live, you are going to die, and love whoever you want to love, and you are going to miss him or get separated of him, you know, and do whatever you want to do, and you are going to be rewarded, you know, for it, you know, in the hereafter. In that hadith, Sayyidina Jibreel added two things, you know. He came with five things. Three of them, they are mentioned here in this paragraph, you know. And the other thing, وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ شَرَفَ الْمُؤْمِنِ قِيَامُ اللَّيْلِ. The honor of the believer when he has night prayer. And عِزَّهُ اسْتِغْنَاءُهُ عَنِ النَّاسِ. To have an honorable position in this life when he is free or he is of no need of any of the other. Okay, he gets himself, you know, self-sufficient, you know, is of no need of anyone else. Okay, so here you take it as a hadith. For these three components have been mentioned here. To be honest with you, in our life we build a lot, you know, about them. Okay, about our life, even though my father, my grandfather passed away, you know, at certain age, I feel myself, you know, I'm going to live much longer than them, okay? Because I'm from different type, you know, or different style or whatever, which is not the case. I'm fooling myself, you know, by this, okay? And the second point, we tend to love some other people, you know. The person may love his children, may love his spouse, may love this or that, and they think that this is one of the strongest relation in this life, which is not the case, because any relation in this life is going to be distorted, you know, because of the matter of this life. And you see it a lot, you know, nowadays, you know, you raise up your children in your house, you know, and especially here in US, you know, when they reach 15 or 18, for the natural position, you know, or procedure to go away, you know, from the house, you know, of their parents, you know. And this is, you know, we hasten it, you start to practice it before it's practiced, you know, on us. And the third one, which is perhaps the most important one, you know, about your deed. Whatever you do of right or wrong matters, you know, you are going to be rewarded according to it. And all of you, or most of you, they have heard, you know, Surah Zalzala. فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَى وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَى. There's no doubt that we are going, yani here, really, for me, it's very important point, you know. We feel ourselves that as a free, we are not free at all, okay? We even though we may do, in some occasion, not in all occasion, we may do whatever we want to do, but all of those matters, they are going to be written down, you know, and they are going to be shown to us one day, and we are going to be rewarded, you know, and according to those matters that we have done, you know, either in the good way or in the bad way, you know, in our standard. So that's why he summarized, Imam al-Ghazali here, he summarized the three items mentioned in that particular hadith narrated by Tabarani. Qurani, and according to many scholars, it has a sound chain, okay? And in that particular hadith, you have five of them, they are mentioned. Any question? No question, we'll move to another paragraph, which is, I think, a little bit longer. Ayyuhal Walad, ayyu shay'in hasilun laka min tahsil ilmi al-kalam والخلاف والطب والدواوين والأشعار والنجوم والعروض والنحو والتصريف غير تضييع العمر بخلاف ذي الجلال إني رأيت في إنجيل عيسى عليه وعلى نبينا صلى الله عليه وسلم من ساعة أن يوضع الميت على الجنازة إلى أن يوضع في على شفير القبر يسأل الله تعالى بعظمته منه 40 سؤالا أولا يقول عبدي طهرت منظر الخلق سنين وما طهرت منظر ساعة وكل يوم ينظر في قلبك يقول ما تصنع لغيري وأنت محفوف بخيري أما أنت فأصم لا تسمع.
O child, what have you gained from the acquisition of the knowledge of scholastic theology and the differences of opinion therein, of medicine and therapeutics, of poetry and astronomy, of prosody and grammar, and the rules of conjugation, other than having wasted a lifetime in opposition of the owner of majesty? I have read in the gospel of Jesus, blessings and peace be upon him and on our prophet, from the time the dead person is laid upon the bier until it is put down at the edge of the grave, Allah in his grandeur asks him 40 questions. The first one of them is, my servant, for years you cleaned and groomed your appearance for the glances of your fellow creatures, but not an hour did you spend purifying yourself for my sight, which penetrates into your heart every day. And he says, what do you do for other than me while you are steeped in my goodness? But you are deaf as deaf can be and do not hearken.
Here he highlighted certain points, you know, of the highest needed, you know, and looked for and worked hard for them, you know, in this life, you know, in our standard, you know. And here we are not to put them down, you know, they are needed. But they are needed, as I said this morning, you know, for a short period of time, not for a long period of time. You spend a lot of time, you know, studying medicine or studying some poetry or have some astrology, you know, or anything of that regard. For us, you know, for some of us, you know, nowadays, they don't look equal. But in the reality, they may look equal, you know, because you have some thought, you know, about this and about that, you know. Medicine nowadays is considered one of the mainstay, you know, of the humanity, you know, which was not the case, you know, hundreds of years ago and was looked at as any other of astrology or anything else, you know. And you may have it in the future, yeah, this, the dilemma about it, you don't know for how long it's going to last. Let's be practical. In our time, we have some importance, you know, about the medical sciences, you know, in this regard. But is it absolute? No, it's not absolute. It's going to be important, you know, for this physical body as long as it is alive. You know, when we have someone dead, you know, regardless of how much the development, you know, of anything, you know, in this life, what benefit is that dead person is going to get of it? It's nothing, okay? And all of us, we are going to die one day. That's mean for us, it's going to be for certain period. So what he's trying to say, Sayyidina al-Ghazali, many of matters that you get yourself involved in them, many of them, they are useless completely. The others, they may be useful for a short period of time. They may be useless for other period of time, okay? And we tend, let's be careful about it, we tend to spend much more time, you know, for those matters, you know, that we feel that they are useful than what they deserve, you know, for this, you know. And this is why it's a problematic, you know, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the hereafter, the day of judgment in one surah as يَوْمُ التَّغَابُ. Not the meaning of يَوْمُ التَّغَابُ, the unjust day. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to be unjust? It's impossible, you know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just. حَرَّمْتُ الظُّلْمَ عَلَى نَفْسِي جَعَلْتُ بَيْنَكُمْ مُحَرَّمًا. Who is going to be unjust? I am going to be unjust with myself, okay? Because this, my assets, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave me time. And this time will enable me to be at the top, okay? The companion, even though they have an honorable position, you know, they did make it, you know, in this life to achieve to be at the top, you know, the same or less or little bit more, you know, of our age, you know. The companions, you know, you don't read that someone of them, he lived, you know, 1,000 years or more than 100 years or this or that, you know. You have some of them, they pass away, you know, when they were young, the other not, you know. But in general speaking, they achieve something that personally, I look at people nowadays, it's unachievable, you know, for the ordinary man nowadays. How did they get it? In this life, you know, not in the hereafter, not in the heaven, not in the certain setting, you know. But perhaps some of them, they have much worse setting that we have nowadays, okay. Or they have much more poor, you know, environment that we have. They may be more poor, you know, on money than us, many of us. They may be hungry, you know, all the time, you know. Yani, just imagine, I'm going to be as simple as this, you know. If you are hungry, you know, now, you are not going to understand anything of this short text that we have, okay? How did they convey Quran? How did they transmit it? How did they give fatwa or whatever? That's mean they just took from this life, you know. This is my look at them, you know. They took that what's needed, you know, what is sufficient, you know, to survive, you know, in this life, and they spent the rest of the time seeking what? Seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is taken firstly, you know, from the prophetic, you know, dua. What did he say? Allahumma ij'al rizqa ali Muhammadin kafafa. Okay, make the provision, you know, of the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sufficient. What's the meaning of sufficient? It's not that much, you know, that will make you busy, you know, most of the time, you know, with it, you know, and it's not down, you know, to make you astray, you or take you against, you know, or away of what we are interested in. And this is should be our attitude. Okay, yani here. He gave some example. You may agree with some of these examples. You may disagree with other examples. But the whole point which I'm going to try to highlight here, you should be careful, you know, about the time spending you have, okay? Because this is your money. Many of them, they express that this is your money. You have money in your hand. What is your money? The money is your time, okay? How do you spend it, you know? Have you achieved those high ranks, you know, closer to companion, or you have done, you know, otherwise, you know. Yani, what I observe, correct me if I'm wrong, you know, for in the website, you know, or whatever, you know, many of us, you know, they spend hours and hours. They may spend days and days, you know, without any benefit at all, you know. Assalamu alaikum. Alaikum salam. What's the point of it, you know? I'm telling someone in India or in China, assalamu alaikum. What benefit I'm going to get? Nothing. Okay. Then I have eaten today pizza. Okay. So what's the point of it, you know? You see, yani we waste our time, we waste our effort, we waste our intelligence, you know, in many aspects of this matter that they are of no point, you know. If it's not haram, it's something that is useless, you know, for you. It's not going to give you any benefit, you know, in the hereafter. And the companion and those Sufi, you know, they were the most one, you know, warrior, the most warrior, you know, about these matters, and to waste any of their time, you know, without having something of that regard, you know, that make them closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he highlighted, firstly, I don't know how to express it. Secondly, really, I feel ashamed of myself, okay? Because I am the worst practitioner of it, you know, okay? Let me be thorough with you. Now I'm giving you this session, okay? I'll be having a lot of concern, you know, if this is going to be accepted, you know, from you or not. Are you going to be pleased, you know, with me with it or not? Those who arrange it, are they going to invite me again or not, you know? This is going to be my concern. I don't have that concern, you know, about the acceptance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is real problem, you know, for me. And you see, I'm going to feel myself like a nut, you know, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to address me in the way mentioned in this narration, you know, from Sayyidina Isa ibn Nura, that you have took care, you know, of everyone, you know, except myself. What I'm going to say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that you have a concern, you know, about everyone except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything, yani, or everyone, when you add it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, compare it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's negligible, it's zero. Okay, cipher, you know, nothing there, you know. But whereas is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is everything. And that's why the poet, he said, لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ إِذَا فَارَقْتَهُ عِوَضُهُ وَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ إِنْ فَارَقْتَ مِنْ عِوَضِهِ. Okay, anything that you may miss in this life, you may find a substitute. When you have significant bankruptcy, when you have paralysis, you know, Allah al-afiyah, when you have any of those physical or spiritual diseases, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to give you some compensation, you know, some substitute to this, you know. But whenever you miss Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what substitute you are going to get? If they brought to you, you know, the whole life, you know, the whole world, you know, everything on this land, you know, or whatever, you know, what benefit you'll get from it? You're missing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what is the most, the worst, you know, thing about it? What is the worst thing about it? When you don't know the value of it. Okay? And here, as a Muslim, I'm speaking about Muslim people. The Muslim people, they have a treasure in their hand. Valuable assets, you know, in their hand. They know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They stand up to have five prayers. Whenever Ramadan comes, they... Okay, the worst among the Muslims, those who don't know the value of those practices, okay? We practice them, you know, but some of us, they don't know the value of it. They said everyone is equal and all of us, we are going to go to heaven. No, no, my friend, you are completely wrong. You are in a position that you don't know the value of the thing given you to you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is my first look is going to be. I have another look. I don't know if you share the other look with me, okay? And these matters, you know. I don't know how to speak, you know. The Prophet ﷺ sacrificed, you know, a lot, you know, to make these five prayers, you know, come to everyone, available for everyone. To make this Holy Qur'an, you know, you have these copies, you know, put in shelves, you know, in your mosque, you know, and in your house and elsewhere, and whatever. It's... For me, I hate myself, you know. Really, I'm going to hate myself if I put down this sacrifice done by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I say, no value of it, you know. So what, you know, Abu Jahl, who did not know this value, and myself, we are the same, you know. We have no difference, you know, in this, you know. Abu Jahl worked hard, you know, to put down the five prayers, put down the verses, you know, and I put them up. We are the same. No, we are not the same. Okay? We are not the same in the scale of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are not the same in the scale if you really love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We are not that scale in our perfect religion, which has been mentioned described by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a perfect religion. And that's why, yani here, I don't want to move, you know, and speak about all of these issues, you know. Let's go back to the first one that he mentioned here. Really, yani, I feel myself, you know, ashamed of myself, you know, to speak up about it, to describe it, you know. A'udhu billah that I may be faced, you know, with this, you know, one time, you know, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to address me. How come you made all of these arrangements, you know, you paid your attention to all of these assets, you know, and you forgot to pay an attention to me, you know. And really, this should bother anyone who believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any question? No question? Everyone tired? I move to next paragraph. أيها الولد العلم بلا عمل جنون والعمل بلا علم لا يكون واعلم أن العلم الذي لا يبعدك اليوم عن المعاصي ولا يحملك على الطاعة لن يبعدك غدا عن نار جهنم وإذا لم تعمل بعلمك اليوم ولم تدارك الأيام الماضية تقول غدا يوم القيامة فارجعنا نعمل صالحا فيقال يا أحمق أنت من هناك تجيء.
O child, knowledge without practicing it is insane, and practice without knowledge is not possible. And know that the knowledge which does not keep you away from rebellion today and does not carry you upon the path of obedience will not keep you away from the fire of hell tomorrow. And if you do not act upon what you know today and do not make up for what you missed in the days gone by, then tomorrow on the day of judgment you will say, make us return so that we shall work righteous deeds. And it will be said, O fool, you just came from there.
I would like to highlight 2 points. The first point, how you should look in a balanced way to the your knowledge and your practice. Okay, I don't mean in your knowledge, you know, your degree, you know, or your PhD or whatever. The knowledge that is going to work for you, you know, in the hereafter, you should have it in a balanced way, you know, with your practice, you know, as highlighted, you know, by Sayyidina al-Ghazal. The second point, all the audience now here in this hall, you still have an opportunity. You still have a chance for improvement, okay? But this is not going to last forever. One day, inshallah, none of the audience, you know, but we have no doubt, one day some of the humankind, they are going to have the wishes that they will be in your position. You are now in a position that you have some chance, you have some opening, you have something, you know, done from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to your person, to your people, you know. But this is not going to last forever, okay? And we read in Qur'an that some of the humankind, they are going to have these wishes, you know, which is at least in the level, you know, of our thoughts, you know, it's impossible, you know, to have it, to go back, you know. We have never heard, you know, about anyone, you know, who returned back to this life, you know, after this. Any question? Very good. Move to another paragraph. أيها الولد اجعل الهمة في الروح والهزيمة في النفس والموت في البدن لأن منزلك الفقر القبر وأهل المقابر ينتظرونك في كل لحظة متى تصل إليهم إياك أن تصل إليهم بلا زاد. قال أبو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه هذه الأجساد قفص الطيور أو إسطبل الدواب فتفكر في نفسك من أيهما أنت إن كنت من الطيور العلوية فحين تسمع طنين طرد ارجعي إلى ربك تطير صاعدا إلى أن تقعد في أعالي بروج الجنان كما قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم اهتز عرش الرحمن من موت سعد بن معاذ والعياذ بالله إن كنت من الدواب كما قال الله تعالى أولئك كالأنعام بل هم أضل فلا تأمن انتقالك من زاوية الدار إلى هاوية النار. وروي أن الحسن البصري رحمة الله تعالى عليه أعطى أعطي شربة ماء بارد فأخذ القدح ووشي عليه وسقط من يديه فلما أفاق قيل ما لك يا أبا سعيد قال ذكرت أمنية أهل النار حين يقولون لأهل الجنة أن أفيضوا علينا من الماء أو مما رزقكم الله. لو كان العلم المجرد كافيا لك لا تحتاج إلى عمل سواه لكان نداء هل من سائل هل من مستغفر هل من تائب ضائعا بلا فائدة. وروي أن جماعة من الصحابة رضي الله عليهم أجمعين ذكروا عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنهما عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال نعم الرجل هو لو كان يصلي بالليل. وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام لرجل من أصحابه يا فلان لا تكثر النوم بالليل فإن كثرة النوم بالليل يدع صاحبه فقيرا يوم القيامة.
O child, strengthen the spirit with zeal and overcome the lower self and mortify the body. For your abode is the grave and the people of the graves await you any moment when you will join them. Beware, beware that you do not join up with them without provisions. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu said, these bodies are either a bird's cage or a stable for beasts. So ponder by yourself, which of the two applies to you? If you are from among the high-flying birds, then when you hear the beating of the drums calling, return to your Lord, you will fly high up until you alight on the highest towers of paradise. As the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, the throne of the All-Merciful trembled at the death of Sa'd ibn Mu'adh. And may Allah protect you from being one of the beasts, as Allah the Exalted said, those are like the beasts, nay, even they are more astray. So do not feel secure. You may transfer from the homeliness of the house to the bottomless pitch of the fire. It has been reported that Hassan al-Basri, may Allah have mercy on him, was given a drink of cold water. When taking the drinking vessel, he fainted and it dropped from his hand. When he regained consciousness, he was asked, what came over you, O Abu Sa'id? He replied, I remember the yearning of the people of fire when they say to the people of paradise, pour down upon us some of the water or anything of anything that Allah has provided for you.
Now, physically, you... Sorry.
If mere knowledge were sufficient for you and you needed not act upon it, then the appeals, is there anyone who asks for something? Is there anyone who seeks forgiveness? Is there anyone who repents? Would be in vain and meaningless. It is reported that once a group of the Prophet's companions, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, made mention of Abdullah, the son of Umar, may Allah be pleased with both, the father and the son, in the presence of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, he, Abu Abdullah ibn Umar, is a fine man, would that he performed prayers during the night. And he, the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, told one of his companions, oh, so-and-so, do not sleep excessively during the night because excessive night sleep brings poverty upon the sleeper on Resurrection Day.
All of us, we are given three items. We should know how to handle these three items that they were given from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have your body, physical. Then you have two spiritual matters or things they were given to you. Firstly, your body, this is the instruction of Imam al-Ghazali, make it dead. Okay. Don't kill yourself, okay. What the meaning of making it dead, okay? Oppress down, you know, the desire of eating, the desire of nice clothes, the desire, you know, of showing yourself, you know, over the others, you know, and not to tolerate to the other. You should tolerate the other. The desire to go according to my passion, you know. All of those oppressing, you know, measurement, they are called, you know, in some of book of Tasawwuf as this, you know. And here even Imam Ghazali was not specific, you know, about these matters, you know, but he called upon having the death, you know, of your body, not by suicide, not by killing itself, you know, physically, by killing itself spiritually, okay? And those, they were done, you know, to the Prophet and the companion from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's side. You recite in Qur'an, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعَ نَقْسِ مِنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ. They were tested, you know, those sadatina wa mawalina, by some hunger, by some insecurity, you know, in their life, you know. And just imagine it. I'm going to repeat myself. We are drowned in the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are quite secure. We have this nice food, you know, that we eat, okay? We should at least, we should remember the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is a verse in the Quran. When I say it's a verse of the Quran, you should pay your attention to it. This was the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When I have otherwise life, you know, I should be massively and excessively, you know, thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Secondly, I shouldn't waste my time, shouldn't waste my purpose, you know, by having those as my target, you know, or my dream, you know, or something of that regard. These are gifts from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help you, you know, live decent life, you know, for a short period of time, and then you are good. And the most the luckiest among us, you know, those who have used this, you know, for the sake of the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This came to my attention. This came to my attention that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala nowadays is quite angry with many Muslim people. Why? Why he is too angry with many Muslim people? Because most of the Muslim people, you know, they seek their benefit, you know. They are concerned about their benefit, you know. They speak up, you know, about it. They may not sleep for it, you know. They may work hard for it, you know. They may sacrifice many things, you know, for it, you know. But unfortunately, among the Muslim, I'm not speaking about the other people. Among the Muslim, you hardly find anyone, you know, seek the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Put the priority of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instruction, okay? For sure, here, all of us, we should be familiar with two components, okay? Amr. Command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These commands from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our scholars, they subdivided, you know, to two. One of them, Amrun Takwini. He will say, he is of no need of your people, you know, at all, you know. Of no need of the angels, of no need of anyone, okay? وَمَنْ نَصْرُ إِلَّا مِنْ عِدِ اللَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent 3,000 or 5,000 of the angels, yet what did he say? وَمَنْ نَصْرُ إِلَّا مِنْ عِدِ اللَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of no need of anyone's help, and for this Amr Takwin, this command that is going to be, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants it to be, no one, even the whole creation, if they gather to say, no, it's not going to be, they are going to be overruled. All of them. This is very important point. Why? Because look at the other thing. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Aqimu salah, this is not amr takwini. It's not command, you know, to be. This is instruction given to you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? If it was amr takwini, you are going to find the billions and billions of people nowadays, you know, all of them, they pray, you know. Because no one can stop this command from Allah. This is, we call it amr tashri'i. Okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed you to do so. Why did I put them together? Just to tell myself, you know, and the others, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of no need, you know, of our prayer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of no need of any of these commands. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not instruct us, you know, to do this, you know, to get some benefit from us or to show to the others that those people, you know, prostrate for me or whatever of that regard or pay charity or whatever. This is for what? This is for our benefit. As our friend, you know, asked me this morning, how come, you know, even those, the lover of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whenever they work for their benefit, not so for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he's quite right, you know. And this is the whole point behind it. Even when you are the most excellent worshiper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who had the best relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or anything of that regard, you are giving the benefit to yourself, you know. You are not giving the benefit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this should be, all of us, we should quite understand it very well, you know, and try to give the priority to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instruction than our instruction. And that's why we are concerned a lot, you know, about this body. You know, when a doctor, you know, told me that I have cancer or I have diabetes, some of us may not even sleep, you know, because of the concern about it. When a wali tell me you have dead heart, so, no, I don't have dead heart, you know. I'm going to defend myself, you know, and do. Do you say this to the doctor? No, you don't say it to the doctor. You don't tell him, you know, no, I don't have cancer. No, you just start crying, you know, and I'm going to die, and this and that, you know. But when a wali tell you that you have a dirty heart, okay, black heart, you know, unpleasant heart, you know, very foul smell heart. So what, you know, I don't care about this, you know, alhamdulillah, I have been covered, you know, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one is going to smell except that person, you know. I try to avoid him. I'm not going to meet with him, you know. I am going to have nice life, you know, with the others, you know, trying to fool them, you know. I'm going to have a stage, you know, and speak, you know, openly for them, speaking about Allah, have good time, you know, about it, you know, and I don't care at all about it, okay. So here, what did he say? Sayyidina al-Ghazali, I'm not going to make it very long story. You have three items, you have your body, make it dead, you know, not by suicide, okay. Secondly, you have two unseen things to you. One is called ruh, and the other one called nafs in Arabic, okay. I'm not here to speak about the controversy, are they one item, you know, or two items, but here he wants you, Sayyidina al-Ghazali, to upgrade and make it too high, you know, your spirit or your soul to have this connection with the angel or al-mala al-a'la. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the Qur'an, mala al-a'la, the highest noble people, you know, or noble angels, not people, you know, this mala al-a'la, ma kana liya min 'ilmin bil mala al-a'la yahtasimun. You should upgrade yourself, you know, in your soul, you know, to get closer to those people, you know. I told you yesterday, some of the companion and the other, they build their relation, you know, with the angels. They build their relation with the spirits, you know, in a way. You see, I am quite sure, you know, the Prophet ﷺ did say that intercession, shafa'ah, the hereafter, they are for angels, for prophets, for scholars. For scholars, we enjoy our time. My sheikh is the best, you know, and your sheikh is the best, you know, and all of us, we are the best, you know, and no one is similar to us, you know, and I'm not going to listen to my sheikh at all. Just I take the cell phone. Good morning, you know, this by saying good morning to my sheikh, I would like to be one of the best person, you know, and is going to intercede for me in the hereafter. Okay. It's complete. Completely wrong, you know, behavior from my side. Okay. This is for the physical assets that we have. What's about the non-physical? What do I mean by it? Yeah, the Prophet ﷺ said there's intercession of the angels, prophets, and scholars. Okay, scholars, you took care of it, you know, bad care. What's about prophets? Have you built any relation with a prophet? Okay. Then, have you built any relation with an angel? Have you built any relation with the angel of death? Many people, you know, they feel that this is horrible one, you know. Whereas, to be honest with you, I think one of the most beautiful ones, you know, angel of death. Why? Why? I'm going to be scientific here, okay? If now I am dead, you know, most of you, they are going to run away. Some they carry me, you know, and bury me or whatever you do. Okay, what is it, you know? Here, you have something nice in me called soul. And that's what make everyone, you know, sit and listen to me. If this is taken away from me by the angel of this, I'm going to be left with what? With this lousy body, you know, and everyone is going to run away. Yeah, what I'm trying to say, the angel of death is going to take from the humankind what? The best thing, you know, inside him, you know. That's why I look at the angel of death as one of the most beautiful, you know, and most perfect, because he take what's the best, you know, inside yourself, doesn't take those lousy, you know, and I don't want to use the bad language, you know, about what's inside yourself, you know. It's going to leave all of these matters, you know, to you, you know, and take that's just the best thing, you know, from you, you know, and take it and go away, you know, in it, you know. Okay. So have you have any relation with the angels? Yesterday we mentioned that when Afzadat in Abani Najjar, he was speaking with Sayyidina Jibreel, the Prophet ﷺ confirmed it. We know that Sayyidina Ibn Abbas, he did see it, Sayyidina Jibreel. Was confirmed by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We know that, yeah, I'm going to tell this story, you know, Medina al-Munawwara in old days, it used to be patches, you know, and between these patches, you know, you may have like interruption, you know, or some enemies, or you may be killed or whatever. It was not as a united city, you know, completely, you know. And one day, the mother of Sayyidina Hudhayfa, she said, how long you haven't seen the Prophet? He said, for many, many days. And she blamed him a lot. Go and pray with the Prophet. And he went to pray Salat al-Maghrib with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who? Sayyidina Hudhayfa. When he finished prayer and went to about to get out, he found someone, you know, standing with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They have a lot of adab, you know. He just passed. Waited for the Prophet because he, the main purpose, you know, to come and pray in the Masjid Nabawi to say Assalamu alaikum to the Prophet, not by telephone, you know, Assalamu alaikum, bitutin al mawajaha, you know. He said, have you seen this? He said, yes. This is an angel came seek permission from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to come and visit me. And he brought a good news with him that Al-Hasan al-Husayn, they are Sayyida Shababi Ahli al-Jannah. Okay? Yani, just imagine, an angel seek permission from Allah to visit the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and is going to bring a present with him to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman, by his mother, you know, his blessed mother, you know, go there and he observed that angel, okay? Have you observed any angel in your life? Okay, that's mean you don't have a relationship, you know. You don't have friendship, you know, with those angels. Don't wish to have intercession, you know, from them. Just build some relation, okay? Try to understand, you know. قل من كان عدوا لجبريل فإنه نزله على قلبك بإذن الله مصدقا لما بين يديه وهدى وبشرى للمؤمنين. Okay, these are description of an angel called Jibril in the Quran. Did you spend some time, you know, to understand when did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want to tell you, you know, about Sayyidina Jibril or not? Okay, about Sayyidina Mikael or not, or you name it, okay. All of these matter. You have a famous scholar, you know, called Imam Suyuti, collected for you all that is, you know, related to some angels. Why? This is my understanding. I may be right or wrong. He wants you to build your relation with the angels. Okay. And this is one of the way to get your ruh or your soul up. Then yourself, you know, your nafs, put it down. Okay? Don't give it, you know, whatever in the mind, you know, of it. Put it down, crush it, okay? Try to squeeze it, try to oppress it, try to kill it, and whatever. Why? Some may ask, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala create this nafs? Your sustenance, you know, you're not sustained, you know, without eating and drinking, okay? And those matter, they are driven, you know, from your nafs, you know. The nafs, the soul is not going to ask you to eat or drink or sleep or whatever. It's going to ask you to fly all the time, you know, and you are going to be crazy, you know, among the people. You know? Whereas the nafs will tell you, I'm hungry, eat. Okay, when you give whatever has been asked or requested from the nafs, you know, excessively, you are going to find this problem. Out of my experience, and this is lesson for all of us, I work in Saudi Arabia. Now, this generation that I work with, you know, they have this massive opening of eating, you know. What did happen to them? They have diabetes, they have hypertension, they have osteoarthritis, they are quite obese. Yeah, all of this. Why? Because this excessive request of the nafs, you know, to eat more, and by eating more, you are going to face all of those physical diseases, you know, in your life, you know. Besides those physical diseases, is there any other diseases, you know, that you may face? Yes. When you fill your stomach, you may sleep, you know, and miss night prayer. When you have good time, you know, busy enjoying your time, you know, something, you know, Either you may commit sin, you know, against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or you may waste something, you know. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we read it in Shema al-Tirmidhi, you know, when they, he did not have a bed, you know. He has abaya, okay, some type of clothes, which is not similar to our clothes, you know. It's much higher, you know, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to use it, you know, but physical description of it is much lower than ours, you know, okay. And he used to have, this is the bed of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to have two layers, you know, of this abaya, and is going to lie down, you know. There's no floor like this, you know. You have the soil, you have the stones, you have everything, you like. You hardly find it in U.S. here, you know, like a land, you know, the natural land, you know, how it contains soil and stone, and you name it. And this was the grand, you know, of the rooms of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wives. One time, his wife figured out she wants to have the Prophet more relaxed. She made it, you know, four layers instead of two. And the Prophet said, what did you do to my sarir, to my bed, you know? Return it back to whatever it was, you know, because I was not able to have night prayer that particular day. You see, yani, very trivial changes. Very trivial physical change, you know, make the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam feel unhappy, you know, about it, you know, and ask the people around him to return back to its original, because he want to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see? So here, really, I like this summary, you know, from Sayyidina al-Ghazali. Maut badanak, put yourself down, you know, and you put your soul, you know, up. You know, and this is the main task that you have in this life, you know, okay? You have a component, you know, inside yourself. It descended to you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The main purpose, you know, behind it, to make you fly back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some people, because of malpractice, because of wrong behavior, they are going either to kill this noble, you know, sophisticated item given to them from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or make it the weakest, you know. Like a bird, you know, when you put it in a cage, you know, you are, if you did not kill that bird, you know, but you made him, you know, unable to fly, you know, or have anything of the practice that you expect from any bird, you know. And this is what happened to many of us, you know. We don't feel anything, you know. We don't feel, and the worst about it, what is it, you know? When you don't feel that you miss something. This is the major problem. You don't feel that you are missing anything. Why? Because you have a lot of food, you have a lot of clothes, you have a nice house, and you have a nice car. Or you are not missing anything. No, my friend, you are missing a lot. You are missing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You are missing, you know, those good nights, you know, good nice recitation of the Qur'an. You are missing, you know, your experience during Ramadan when you pray Taraweeh, you know, and you have your heart softened, you know, about this, behind that nice recital of the Qur'an Kareem. You miss all of these matters. You are missing, as mentioned by Imam al-Ghazali, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala every night, he say, whoever has anything, let him, you know, ask me, give me your good. Whoever seek for my forgiveness, let him seek, ask me for forgiveness. Whoever seek repentance, and you name it, okay? You are missing all of these matters, you know. So it's a disaster, you know, to miss them, you know, and what is much worse, you know, as a disaster, not to feel the missing of them, you know. Okay? Not knowing that you have missed something, you know. Okay? Yes?
You were talking about forming relationships with prophets, with angels, with Sahaba.
No.
Is that relationship formed by just learning more about them, or is there something else to forming those relationships?
I'm sorry, you are not asking, you know, the experience when you know, but in theory, I'm going to answer, you know. It starts by knowing, secondly by loving, thirdly by experiencing. Okay, you are going firstly to know about them, then to love them, and thirdly to experience some of your experiences, you know, with them.
So from the first step to the second step, from knowing to loving, how does that occur?
All of us, even the brothers, you know, among themselves, they are going to find that they have their own nature, you know, which may differ of his brother. This brother, you know, loves the hot weather, the other one, the cool one, or the cold one, you know, and you name it, you know, the two, earth, wood, and everything, you know. And in the same pattern, you know, you are going to find the difference between a brother and brother, you know, in their look, in their attitude, in their experience, you know, about those spiritual matter, you know. That's why you may not have something, you know, similar to the nature of your brother, but look to have those angels, they are much more large in number than the humankind. And for sure you are going to find someone who match your nature, you know, as a humankind, you know. And these are, in my view, in theory, you know, the creation of the angels that you would like to build some relation with them. Other question, you know? Then he highlighted at the end of the paragraph about, again, the importance, you know. You see, most of this book, you know, speak about the importance of having combination, you know, of your knowledge and your practice. It's a very important one. And I hope, you know, we cannot, you know, give you, they call it workshop, you know, or something of the, we cannot make workshop for you here for Ayyuhal Walad, you know, but I hope all of your people, you know, they are going to go back and have some workshop, you know, at your home, you know, to practice something. Try to practice night prayer, try to practice, you know, recitation of the Qur'an, try to build your relation with Allah, build your relation with the Prophet, build your relation with the angels, and inshallah, you'll have a benefit there, you know. Any other questions? No more questions? You have one there, Sayyidi. Yes?
Is it the same way to build a relationship with Allah Ta'ala, like you mentioned, for the angels and prophets, like start with knowing and then love and then experience? But the relationship with Allah is different.
You may have some items should be added, you know, when you build your relation with Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. It has been mentioned in the prophetic wording, you know, they are to build your confidence in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and have complete reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the two main items, you know, that you should add to whatever we have seen. Confidence and reliance, or siqa and tawakkul. Yes?
In regards to practicing like a night vigil, the sahra, like what's a proper balance in not overdoing it so you don't?
You mean for the night prayer? For me, this is a tough question, you know. Why? Because all of us, even from my child, since my childhood, you know, when I opened my eyes, you know, to this life, you know, we have the electricity available in our house, okay. In my view, you may differ with me or you disagree with me, this electricity is going to make me, you know, not ready to practice night prayer. How? When you have the power off, you know, regardless how strong you are, you know, you hardly keep up till Isha prayer, you know, because of the darkness, you know, and you're going to go to bed, you know, right away, you know. And this is going to be quite helpful, you know, to practice night prayer. Nowadays, many of us, you know, their activities start after midnight. And, well, it's not a subject, you know, of speaking, you know, about night prayer. Nowadays, I attended here in U.S., some Muslim speakers speak that Bala Shaytanu fi idunay, this is for fajr prayer. And now we have some argument, we have some dispute about fajr prayer, which in my view at least, you know, it's out of discussion, you know. You shouldn't discuss, you know, fajr prayer. Fajr prayer is an obligation, you should do it. Okay, so here basically, I look at this electricity, even though it's a favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it has some problem, you know, to astray us, you know, of practicing night prayer. That's why I did observe some of those good people, you know, or excellent people, you know, back in Syria, they will not stay awake, you know, for a long time, you know, because they have the habit, let's say, to wake up, you know, at 2 a.m., you know, or whatever, you know, and have some night prayer. So here, no trick behind it, you know. We practice it sometimes. How do we practice it? When I have a very important interview, you know, at 8 o'clock, you know, in the morning, I'm going to go to sleep, you know, in early time, you know, I'm going to prepare myself, and in most cases, I'm going to dream that I have missed the appointment. This is the way it's working. Why? Because I have an interview with a person. Here you have an interview with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How did you prepare yourself, you know? You should have a lot of main concern, a lot of planning done, you know, and a lot of proposal, you know, to be done, you know, to achieve this. I may not be able to answer all of these problems because as I see people, you know, they are different here. Every one of your people, you know, they have different problems than the other one, you know, and you cannot put all of them, you know, for the general answer. But generally speaking, you know, whenever you spend much more time, you know, speaking, you know, or watching TV or dishes, you know, or whatever of that regard, this is going to take away the night prayer, you know, of you. And it's a matter of habitual matter, you know. Yani, I know about certain people, they have a habit, you know, of having, you know, night prayer. The other, they don't have this habit, you know. And that's why for your children, you know, try to train them from the beginning, you know, to have some habit, you know, of waking up, you know, overnight and make some prayer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Other questions?
There was a question that came over that says, can you explain confidence in Allah?
Okay. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam specified the confidence that he is much more confident in whatever in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's hand than his own hand. Okay. How to build this confidence? In my view, by knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by knowing the perfect description of His attribute, perfect description of His name, perfect description of His action. There is another way of building the confidence. I look at your people nowadays. I see all of you, you know, you are normal people. Have been raised up, you know, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, helped by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of you are healthy, you know. So from my experience, I'm going to look back to my experience with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which has been for more than 60 years, you know. How was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with me? I cannot say great, it's the greatest, you know, it's the best. All of those wordings that you are going to use, they are going to be much less than the reality of it. This is my experience with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you have any experience, I had to give this example. When you have, let's say, 1%, you know, of this experience with Allah and a person, you are going to give him the full confidence, okay? Do you do it or not? When you have a person, you know, sick person, you know, he seek medical advice, you know, and the physician failed, you know, to cure him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the second one and the third one, you know, you have a bad experience with 20 of these physicians or doctors, you know, and then, because you are lucky, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made you go to a physician number 21, 21st, okay? Who the cure was given to you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through that person, you know, who was 21st. Are you going to trust that physician or not? Are you going to obey complete submission, you know, to that physician or not? I think we are going to do it, you know. Some of us, they may say no, okay, but in the practical life, all of us, we are going to give full submission, you know, because out of experience. Okay, look at your experience with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How do you comment about it? I say, subhanallah. How many times, you know, in my life, I'm speaking about myself, that I would like this to happen, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not make it happen, and now I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a lot that it did not happen. How many times I felt that those matters, you know, they are going to be almost impossible to be achieved, you know. To be honest with you, you know, when I was young, you know, I felt myself, you know, it's impossible to know how to drive car, you know, or get married, you know, or have children or whatever, you know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it much more than that my expectation, you know, about. So what I'm trying to say, you have all of us, you know, without exception, I don't see any exception here, you know. All of us, we have built our confidence in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out of our experience with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Other questions?
Inshallah, we'll take a break. This one's scheduled to be a little bit longer just because we have CDMAs today and we don't have them tomorrow. So maybe we can have a sheet break until, it's scheduled till 3:15 inshallah. So maybe we'll have 15, 20 minutes of a sheet, and if you need to use that, we'll take a go outside and do that as well.